All these people have said no to death. Their bodies are frozen, lying in suspended animation in pools of liquid nitrogen, waiting for the day when a future generation will bring them back to life, in a world where aging and even death are things of the past.
Eternal youth, medicine's mastery of aging. It's one of science fiction's oldest fantasies. It looks forward to a time when lifespans are measured in centuries, not decades, and where an electronic afterlife awaits us when our bodies have died. Now scientists are starting to unravel the secrets of aging. Could we see a day when these things are possible? When we witness the death of death itself?
It may be very expensive and it may take a long time to conquer death, but it's worth it. I don't care how long it takes or how much science it takes. Once you know how to do it, it will get cheaper like everything else.
Marvin Minsky, world-renowned scientist and visionary.
Try to face the issue. 100 years is a nice long time, but it's not long enough for a human. Even if a human lives twice as long as its closest relatives, the chimpanzee, it's not long enough. We deserve to live 500 years. And everybody should be quite angry about not doing it. Here's your chance.
Come. I will show you what no other living mortal has seen. The flame of eternal life.
I want to better choose when I die, if ever. And so far, I don't really expect to ever choose to die.
I'd like to start the rejuvenation process. I'd like to start growing younger.
Max and Nancy Moore are two of today's would-be immortals.
My life extension program begins with ageless thinking. It's a psychology that helps me maintain a youthfulness and to grow younger. I work out, bodybuild, plenty of water, nutritious diet, vitamins, supplements.
Apart from vitamins, I take things like coenzyme Q10. I'm considering things like DHEA and various other substances that might reverse the decline in the immune system as I age.
But maybe it's not what we put in our bodies which will keep us young, but what we don't put in. It's the latest thinking on life extension. These mice will live twice as long as other mice. They're not taking special pills or potions. They're simply eating a lot less food. It's called caloric restriction. Experiments show it extends life in animals, though no one knows for sure that it works for humans. But some people aren't waiting for proof. They're already trying out this more homely approach to living longer.
Our staple lunch diet is sweet potato and corn and lettuce. What we put on lettuce varies. Sometimes when we're in a hurry or in a rush, we may just have a lot of lettuce.
Rima and Malcolm Greenhill are following a restricted diet for the rest of their lives in the hope of living longer.
I have a computer program. And I've actually inputted all of everything we eat. It's not just calorie restriction. It's calorie restriction with optimal nutrition. Very important. This is not a starvation diet.
In fact, scientists believe that if people were to reduce their calorie intake by a third, we could see lifespans of up to 140. Maybe it's worth trying until something better comes along. Dieting and pills may buy us a few extra years. Maybe even decades.
But if we want to extend our lives dramatically, then we'll need to transform the genetics of the human body. Science will have to rewrite the book of life.
Joseph Klein is 96 years old. His brother Eugene is 98. Their parents and grandparents also live to be very old. Could it be that the secret of long life is in our genes? In Methuselah's Children, Robert Heinlein tells the story of a people who were bred to live for hundreds of years. Maybe it's not such an impossible idea.
Mankind will postpone human aging substantially in the future, doubling human lifespan at least. When we've accomplished this, we will be ashamed that we didn't work on it much sooner.
Michael Rose, an evolutionary biologist following in the footsteps of science fiction.
I read this book called Methuselah's Children by Robert A. Heinlein probably when I was 12. And it's hilarious for me now because in this book there's kind of a parable of my whole career.
The extraordinary lifespans of Methuselah's children were acquired by selectively breeding men and women over generations. Rose has been doing his own breeding experiments to increase longevity, not with humans, but with flies. Rose bred together strains of flies that reproduced late in life. After generations of breeding, he'd created a superfly, living twice as long as its ancestors.
The fact that we were easily able to mold aging in fruit flies tells us that, in principle at least, you could easily mold human aging.
And Rose believes that we can't start soon enough.
I've been working away for 20 years on making flies happier and longer lived. Meanwhile, in barbaric splendor around me are people aging at an appalling rate, racing toward the grave.
So what can we do for humans? Selective breeding would take hundreds of years. But there's a quicker way, and for once, it depends on something that science fiction failed to predict. The discovery of DNA.
That surely is it.
I feel like Pygmalion. You build something beautiful, and it comes to life. All we wanted was the body, and we've got the soul. The secret of life itself. Peel the chains apart, and each chain reproduces the other. One becomes two, two becomes one, generation on generation, all the way from Adam and Eve to you and me. It's the closest we'll ever get to immortality, Jim.
If our lifespan is written into our DNA, maybe we can rewrite it. As unbelievable as this sounds, it's already been done for nematode worms. Thanks to genetic engineering, these worms will live six times as long as nature intended. The biologist who achieved this was Siegfried Hakimi.
We've discovered a number of genes which, when altered, make the worm live long.
Hakimi has found nothing less than the gene which controls the biological clock. To produce a longer life, he reset the clock.
It's very likely that humans have some form of biological clock which regulates everything, the rate at which they do things, and there would be genes which of course, whose activity will regulate, will allow this mechanism to function properly. We have not found them in humans yet, but that might come soon.
Especially if Dr. Francois Schechter has anything to do with it. Schechter's team have an extraordinary resource at their disposal, the DNA of 500 long-lived families. If the genes for long life are anywhere, they're in this blood bank. And if Schechter manages to find them, the implications would be earth-shattering. At long last, the lifespans of science fiction would be ours for the taking.
If we understand the intrinsic clock of aging, then we should be able to slow it down to a great extent and perhaps to live a few centuries, few centuries, few centuries.
Think about it. Many of us alive today might live until the 22nd century. And theoretically, we could engineer a new generation with lifespans of 300 to 400 years. But science fiction has never liked this idea.
I have an absolutely horrific sense of what might happen if, say, we were able to live 200 years. The only thing you can do with old people who are extremely wise and powerful is boot them into space, where they can find new worlds to conquer.
But some are a little more positive.
I think until recently, most science fiction writers seen longevity as a bad thing because of lack of imagination. Essentially, they've rejected this condition we're in as lasting for millions of years without changing. Well, of course, that will be boring, but that's not what's going to happen. We're going to leave the planet, we'll change our physical form, and I think the number of lifestyles we can have is infinite.
Despite the optimism of the scientists,
there's no guarantee that it'll happen in our lifetimes. But if you want to make sure you're around when it does, you'll have to put life on hold.
It could be a long, cold wait if you decide to have your body frozen.
Oh. I predict that within the next couple of centuries at most, our patients in cryonic suspension will be revived and rejuvenated to live and love again for as long as they choose.
Dr. Robert Ettinger, pioneer of the cryonics movement.
And then, of course, the idea of freezing people for eventual revival in various forms is very old, but the particular story that I noticed was in the 30s, a story about a Professor Jameson called the Jameson Satellite.
In the depths of space, some 20,000 miles from the Earth, the body of Professor Jameson cruised upon an endless journey circling the gigantic sphere.
In this science fiction tale, Professor Jameson remains frozen in space for millions of years until he is discovered by an alien race and revived.
It was immediately obvious to me that the author had missed the main point of his own story, because if it made any sense to expect the possibility of eventual rescue by aliens, then why not rescue by our own people very soon?
In his book, The Prospect of Immortality, Ettinger sets out his own ideas for preserving the human race, freezing them in liquid nitrogen.
This book is intended to convince first a substantial number of scientists and intelligent laymen, then the nation, and eventually the world, that the prospect of immortality is not idle speculation.
When I wrote The Prospect of Immortality, I was merely expressing ideas that seemed obvious to me and had seemed obvious since my childhood, but they were not obvious, apparently, to most people, that we had within our power to create the greatest revolutions in human history, to do away with death and dying, and to become superhuman if we chose to do so.
It was a revolution that people were only too willing to be a part of. Suddenly, everyone was demanding to know where they could sign up to be frozen. One of them was Professor James Bedford, and when he died, he became the first person ever to take this great step into the unknown. His body is now lying in suspension, in a vault alongside 31 other hopeful immortals.
I think about the people in here. I know that some of these are people that I have known.
Steve Bridge, president of Alcor.
What I feel is sort of like a caretaker. We're taking care of these people. We still call them patients. And that's the way I feel. It's more like an intensive care unit in a hospital. Maybe you can't see that the person is still there, but you know the possibility is still there that they're going to wake up someday.
But Professor Bedford has been lying here for 30 years. What are his chances of returning to the land of the living?
It's certainly true that the people frozen here have had additional damage from the freezing damage. But it's also very likely that the future repair capabilities will be an immeasurable amount better than what we have today.
Today's cryonics patients are relying on tomorrow's medicine, nanotechnology. It's the science of minute machines which will be able to go where no machines have ever gone before.
I think nanotechnology is the ultimate science fiction dream of the next century. If you could make little machines that are about the same size as the cells of your body, and in principle this looks possible, then you could repair almost every kind of biological damage. One of the fantasies about nanotechnology in the future is that you'll be able to inject swarms of these very small repair machines which can creep around in your body and fix things that look wrong.
And if this miniature medicine works on living bodies, could it work for the frozen?
I think it likely will be able to revive patients who have been cryonically suspended under favorable conditions sometime in the next century.
Ralph Merkel, nanotechnologist at the Xerox Corporation.
My expectation is that the level of damage caused by freezing is extensive, does extend to the cellular level and very likely the molecular level. But clearly in the future, with molecular nanotechnology, we should be able to reverse freezing injury, or at least the kind of freezing injury that occurs in cryonic suspensions.
So the future's looking brighter for these patients all the time. So bright that even Ralph Merkel is banking on it.
I am signed up with Alcor to be cryonically suspended, and indeed I have appropriate bracelet. It says, if you find me in a non-functional condition, then please contact Alcor as quickly as possible.
Ralph, can you hear me? Ralph?
It might be a century, it might be two. But when these hopeful immortals are finally unfrozen, will the wait have been worthwhile? Will they wake to find their dream has finally come true? They may find a world where people routinely live 200 or 300 years. But would that be long enough for them? If they really want to chase the big dream of immortality, they'll have to desert their bodies and find a more permanent home for their minds. At least that's what science fiction says.
The cyberpunk writers, people like William Gibson and Bruce Sterling, have been very interested in the idea that human beings can hook themselves up to computers.
Brian Stableford, science fiction writer.
One of the first ideas that comes up in many of those stories is the idea that if the person can project themselves into the cyberspace of the computer, what would then happen if their body were killed? Would they still be existing? Would they still be the same person within cyberspace?
In Greg Egan's novel Permutation City, there are two worlds, the real one and a computer version. Real people can enter the computer world by being scanned in. When their flesh and blood versions die, the copies live on. It's called uploading, making an exact copy of our brains and running them on computer. It sounds wild, but could it ever happen?
The human brain, like other physical structures, obeys the laws of physics. The laws of physics can be modeled on a computer. And if you have a very powerful computer, you should be able to model the behavior of the human brain.
It might happen sooner than you think. British Telecom is one of several companies working on storing a person's memories on computer. The next step is to produce a computer copy of a brain, which can think for itself. And the timescale? Sometime in the next century. And guess who'll be the first online?
Uploading appeals to me a great deal. It really means that I can control my consciousness a lot more effectively than I can in its natural biological structure. We eventually are going to have to move out of physical or biological brains. They're not very resilient. They're pieces of jelly, basically.
If the idea of uploading just your head makes you feel claustrophobic, rest assured, you don't have to leave your body behind.
The old science fiction horror notion that you're basically in a black box with a couple of eye holes is not how it would happen. We will upload an analog of our mortal frame as a kind of anchor.
I would be able to be uploaded into various bodily structures, maybe in a shape like this. Maybe I like my shape. Maybe I want to keep it around for a very long time. But this may be just one of my shapes. I may have all sorts of shapes.
Maybe she will. Maybe you will too. If genetics and medicine extend our lives long enough, many of us could live to see the day when uploading is a reality. Computer copies could be made of our flesh and blood originals, copies which in theory would live on forever. In other words, one day we could choose whether we live or die. You may be thinking this is the ultimate, but wait for it. Science has one more trick up its sleeve.
An incredible consequence of the laws of physics as we now understand them is that one day in the far future, super intelligent computers will bring us back into existence and we'll never die again.
Even science fiction can't compete with Frank Tipler, professor of mathematics and author of The Physics of Immortality. His version of uploading includes no less than the resurrection of the dead.
What you can show on the basis of the fundamental physical laws is that the ability to compute, to store information, and to process information will grow literally without limit in the far future. Now, this has a very remarkable consequence. It will become possible to emulate, to make a perfect simulation of the universe as it now exists.
According to Tipler, billions of years from now, our descendants will have enough computer power to upload the entire universe. But that's not all. They'll also upload the whole of life's history, from the very beginning of time.
In other words, you and I will be brought back into existence in the far future. This will be resurrection of the dead.
I think Frank Tipler's ideas come out of his own deep emotional needs. And as ideas, they're amusing. But face it, the promise that 100 billion years from now, you will be simulated in detail in a giant computer is not my definition of immortality. The simulation of yourself is not yourself, period.
Oh, yes, it is, says Frank Tipler.
They will not just reproduce me and reproduce you abstractly. They will reproduce us in the entire world we find ourselves in. We will not even be aware that we are in the computers of the far future. It will seem just like the world behind me and me myself seem. It will be a perfect copy. From the point of view of science, a perfect copy is no longer a copy. It is the original. Not only will we be resurrected, brought back into existence, we will then live forever.
Even if Resurrection Day never comes, ours could be the first generation to live for 200 years. So what kind of life can we expect in our fantastic future?
Teleportation is no longer a fantasy.
We'll be able to build robots indistinguishable from humans.
There will be such a thing as an artificial human being, and they will walk among us, and they will be us, and we will be them.
In the future, we'll be able to record people's experiences.
It will be possible to control gravity.
We will have the technology to build a time machine.
There is life on Mars, and it is us. We are the Martians from here on.
Extraordinary as the dreams of science fiction may seem today, they will pale in comparison with the reality of tomorrow. If you want to imagine what the world's going to be like in the future, don't work from what's possible now. Start by imagining the impossible. Only then will you even get close to a vision of our fantastic future.